side to look for some of the ones, but some scallywag nicked off at my laptop, so I kind of had to improvise a little bit. Yeah, so I'm going to sort of give you a relatively high-level overview of TESS, and then maybe a bit about how we aggregate training resources, the mechanism that we use for that, and then a little bit of a sort of comparison and contrast between what we're doing and what Erudite is doing. So yeah, first and foremost, this is TESS. My name is Niall Beards, so I'm sort of leading the development of it. Finn Piccolo and Milo Thurston are our other developers, and the sub-co-island project is Carol Terry over here, and Susanna from San Antonio. So yeah, we've heard a little bit about Elixir before, but it's this pan-European infrastructure for life sciences. The work, delivery of work is kind of split up into five main platforms: the data, tools, compute, interoperability, and training. And so TESS kind of falls under the training platform. You'll see that what we're doing in TESS is kind of it's a relatively common theme across some of these platforms, but done in slightly different ways. So Elixir and Europe itself is a very, very distributed kind of place. We have about 24 or so Elixir nodes, and each of these nodes may have several different institutions are members of the nodes. So you end up with this very, very complicated picture where each of these institutions and projects across institutions and individuals all produce fantastically useful training resources, or they host face-to-face training events. And they can be quite difficult to find. There's literally hundreds and hundreds of them. So here you can sort of see a few of them. Things like software carpentry and Khan Academy and data carpentry are really large ones that have produced lots and lots of resources. And then you have like smaller, more boutique ones like Birmingham Metabolomics, BioComp, which is the Austrian one. And so how do people find all of these wonderful resources that are being produced across Europe? And the first step is always go to Google, and you can type in your search query. And it's very useful if you know specifically what you're interested in. So if you type in EU McWinter School, you'll find out information about the EU McWinter School. But if you type in just vaguely, I'm interested in proteomics courses, you're going to get a very different result. So so what tends to happen when you type in just proteomics course is you end up with these really large websites that have got very high traffic. They tend to be favored by Google. So there's a small quantity of them that have a very high volume of materials, high volume of traffic, and they get to the top of the search results. But you have lots of high quality, but small, but low quantity resources. And this is more and more of a trend, especially with the proliferation of easy to set up, install, and maintain CMSs like Drupal and Joomla and WordPress, etc. So what we're doing in TESS, I think, really is focusing on raising the exposure of this long tail, these large number of websites that have got small amounts of resources, by bringing them together in one registry. And arguably, parallelly, Erudite kind of focuses on extracting quality from these large quantity resources. So this is a brief overview slide of TESS. So we're mostly about aggregation. We're trying our very best to automate this aggregation. I'll show you a little bit about how we've approached that and our solution to what is a relatively difficult and open-ended question. But we also allow people to manually register their events and materials, so we do kind of depend on the European community of life science trainers to populate our lists. We've provided lots and lots of tools to filter and search and discover. Thought quite considerably about our interface and how people actually go about discovering bits of discovering the resources that they want, and taking some lessons from commercial companies on how that's done. We also have been working more and more recently on what we think is very exciting aspect to the site, which is training workflows. So I'll go into that in more detail, but this is a more novel way of organizing resources that embeds in it some knowledge about the domain and how modules fit together. We're also really keen on not making this in a silo, but as I said, we have these other platforms in Elixir, and making sure that what we do here is interlinked with all the other platforms, that people who are looking for training can also find information about the tools that they're learning about, or vice versa. If you've got a tool, then it would be great to be able to expose training. And with all of the different work packages, we have things like compute infrastructure, we have databases, standards and policies with the BioSharing website, and lots of data sets that you might want to use to be able to complete different training exercises. So we're really thinking a lot. We've done some integration, but we're really thinking about how we can really improve our interlinkage with other resources. One of the other things this is an Elixir project, being able to sort of, you know, that map of all of the different institutions and all the different nodes, being able to have like a shop window that shows you everything that your personal node is doing, like all of the different stuff that is going on in the UK or Switzerland or Norway. So that's still kind of a bit of a work in progress, but we've made some developments there. So this is basically the interface to TESS. So this is like the sort of index page where you can go perusing for relevant materials. And on the left hand side you have all this faceted filtering. So this is similar to Erudite, each resource has been assigned a value from these. So that's what we're working towards anyway. We have different filters such as like content provider, so where we source this information from. What the actual scientific topic is, tools, standards, policies. So you can do like searches that are centric around a particular format or a particular tool that you're interested in, and so on and so forth. Things like difficulty level, license is particularly interesting if you are a trainer yourself and you want to be able to find materials that you would be able to freely reuse in the training that you deliver. And then there's other sort of quite standard search features like ordering and pagination. When you're actually clicking to a material, you have this view perspective of the material. So you can kind of see this has got a link to a tool that's in the Elixir tools registry. It's live pulling information about the home page, about the scientific topic, description of that tool from the BioTools registry. These at the moment can only really be done manually, but we're looking to explore some machine learning approaches to being able to suggest which tools a training tool is about through various name entity recognition applications. So some of the other ways that people can access information in TESS, it's not necessarily about going onto the TESS website, but you're trying to get this information as widely spread as possible to raise the exposure of these training resources. So subscription to calendar feeds is one way in which you can do that. You can sort of select a bunch of filters on the TESS registry here. So you can select different topics and tools and countries and such. And then you get that reduced list of all of the events that match that criteria. So if you're interested in, say, training on a BLAST tool in the UK, you can add those different filters, and then you can subscribe to your calendar. So basically every time you load Google Calendar, you'll consistently update and keep in your personal calendar the incoming opportunities for people who are interested. Another thing is that we also have this service called IAMS. So TESS is kind of like so IAMS is a bit of a predecessor to TESS. And we've kind of like taken over the aggregation of events from them, but we still sort of feed into their database, and their database powers lots of these widgets. So there's several websites out there that have included this line of JavaScript into their site, and it presents all the bioinformatics events in it with this criteria, and you can have a filterable list. So that's another way in which we kind of help share the events that we collect in tests. So here's a little bit about the training workflows. I think this is a really interesting domain, and if anyone finds it as interesting as we do, we'd be very happy to talk to them about it. There's a lot of activity in this area. But the idea is that you can create a graphical representation of an actual computational workflow, or you can create a training material. I'll get into different types of training workflows in a second. But it's this graphical representation that allows you to link to different resources, such as training materials, events, tools, standards, policies, all of these different things at each of these different stages. So you'll be able to basically describe a common biological workflow and associate resources to it. So the training workflows, we kind of created the mechanism to be able to create them. And then we kind of let people loose on it. I think looking at what people have done, everyone seems to have their own different perspective of how training workflows should go. So these are the sort of main kind of ways that we've identified. So one of them is learning pathways. So this is quite similar to some of the stuff that Erudite are working on. So some people want to be able to say that, you know, in order to accomplish some skill, you must follow these steps, these prerequisite lessons that must be learned before you can get to that stage. So that's one way people like to be able to use this workflow stuff to express something of interest to learners. Another way is through sort of mind maps. So so these would be kind of like an exploration of a certain domain. So someone's own perception of like where you should go and how you should explore all the different branches of interest in a specific topic. Learning resources such as Ember, which is a bioinformatics tutorial that Terry wrote. And we also have some funding for new structural bioinformatics, one of these. So this is really where the content of the training is embedded in the workflow. So it's not just that you can interlink resources to each of the different nodes, but you can also add actual content in the text. You can describe what you should do in this position, maybe even have like questionnaires so that the user is interacting and sort of assessing whether or not they've learned correctly what has been told to them. So this is like really the sort of the first-hand information which tests is starting to develop. And then the other one is like computational workflows. So these could be things like Galaxy or Naim or Taverna. The idea would be that we will be able to import them in, and you'd have each of the different stages, and you could describe state information, almost like documentation about what's happening at each of these different computational workflow stages. So the mechanism behind that we intend is through the common workflow language, way of being able to describe any workflow in a common way that could be executed across any platform. That's another thing that Alex is working on now. So improving the metadata in tests. So as I said before, it's aggregated, and that kind of means that we're reliant on people providing information to us. And that's often very, very difficult to be able to get a high quality of annotation in all of our resources if we rely on other people to give it to. So one of the things we're using is the BioPortal's annotator web service. So this is something called OVA. And it's basically, you can send it a description or a text or like all the content of the training material. It does some name entity recognition. It tries to map it to an ontology. We're using the EDOM ontology, which is also currently being supported by Alex here. This is like an ontology of lots of different bioinformatics concepts. And And so what we're doing is producing suggestions for the topics of the resources that we have in TESS. And then we're leveraging the training coordinators network that we have in Alexia. Every single node has a training coordinator who's responsible for discovering the gaps in their country and delivering training and sharing that information and sharing training across Alexia. So we're hoping that once we've got this very simple dashboard, people will be able to come in and accept or reject these suggestions for metadata. So, as I mentioned, we're really keen on doing registry integration, and we're really progressing quite well with that. So now people can add tools that are training tools about, or information from fire sharing that are training tools about. And we're quite interested in somehow automating this through various enablements, which is recognition software. So that's another point that I found very, very interesting talking to the everyday people about. We're also planning to include things like data sets, compute infrastructure, and Dockers. So every country in Alexia has their own relatively unique sort of situation when it comes to what is available to them infrastructure-wise, like the compute infrastructure. So this could be a really interesting part to expand on. Like if you actually have a workflow or a training workflow, a workflow that is like an example that you want to be able to run and demonstrate during a workshop, what infrastructure is available to me to be able to run that? So that's something that we're looking into creating secure information for Alexa. Some brief usage statistics. So we have at the moment about 39 content providers. About 80% of these are automatically aggregated. So we have scripts that pull from them every single night. So if the content does change on the website, if things get edited or new materials get added, then this is automatically updated in tests. The events is difficult because they keep expiring. So statistics would be much better if in sense. We've got quite a lot of ongoing activities with the workflows. So we've been given some funding by Alexa to really develop the infrastructure for those and for the four different types to be able to sort of split those out and provide lots of different options for trainees. And some funding to actually create the content, not just the mechanism. So the structured bioinformatician group within Alexa has been given some funds to produce some new resources for us. And the Galaxy Training Network as well is very keen on contributing to making new workflows. That's just a bit of user information, about 400 or so in the last month. As Louise mentioned before, we're finding more and more people are reporting at workshops that they've discovered events that they've attended through TESS. So brief summary slides. I'm not going to dwell on this because we want to talk to you quite a lot about the actual aggregation procedure. So how do we actually go about aggregating? Well, these large training sites tend to have very clear ways of accessing their data. They're structured, they provide APIs or RSS feeds, but the small ones rarely do. A lot of them are even just handwritten HTML websites. Some of them use CMSs, but they haven't enabled any sort of structured output of the data. So how do we go about bringing those into TESS? Well, you could do it manually. You just eyeball a page, find out where the title, the dates, the descriptions are, fill in a form, but it's not exactly scalable or pleasant task. You find it quite difficult to get someone to do such manual work. The other option is a HTML scraper. So this technique is the kind of one that we really began with. This is about like looking at the HTML structure of a page and just picking out all the different bits of information that you want but if someone changes the style of the page, then it means that the scope is broken, and you pretty much have to start again. So these are very difficult. It kind of feels like spinning plates when you have several different scrapers, and each of them goes down every other day. And it really does build up a lot of technical debt. So schema.org was kind of our solution to this. So websites that don't already have structured data, we ask them to use what I think is an incredibly simple way of structuring their data. And schema.org was sort of started by a consortium of search engines. And they started it in order for people to start structuring their data so that they could better put people into contact with relevant information. And they do this by allowing people to explicitly describe what is the content of their sites. So they have a massive catalog of different vocabularies. Each vocabulary has pretty much any field that you can imagine to be usefully relevant to a vocabulary. So here's an example. You have recipe. This is the BBC Good Food website. And it's got lots of information about nutrition information, weight, how many people it serves, the cooking time. It's all embedded there in the HTML. And what do you want to do? What do? You want to extract that? Of course, you need to have it structured. So BBC website have adorned the HTML with explicit instructions that say the contents of this part of the code is this value. Can also format in different ways in JSONRD. And what Google can then do with that result is it can provide these fact sheets that you have here on the side, where it can obviously talk about the recipe with a relevant amount of confidence that what it's found is about the correct attributes. They also provide quite a few tools to pass, and we've kind of constructed a lot of our own tools to be able to pass the schema.org stuff. And there's lots of tools to help people encode their websites with this with the schema.org stuff. So there's one which is a Google Map helper. You can just put in the name of your website. It loads it. Your website in a small window. You can highlight what parts of it are the title, what parts of the URL, what parts of the locality, information like that. And then it spits out this JSON-LD kind of thing on the right hand side that it's useful to see. But you can copy and paste that and put it into your website, and then tests can parse that, and that information is visible within our registry. It's managed to collect everything. But it's a relatively simple mechanism. It's not as difficult to create as an API or maintain as an API, and it's a lot more expressive than things like RSS feeds. So we found it to be a fantastic solution. So people can do it by hand, or they can use a lot of extensions. I mean, this is it's a very useful tool for search engine optimizations. So there's a lot of companies that have invested the time in manufacturing tools to help people do this. So, like SEO companies will make these, or any content management systems will have lots of extensions for this. So I just want to talk very briefly about bioschemas. So bioschemas is kind of like the name of this working group that tries to make these schema.org vocabularies that we're now relying on for these registries to work really well for our particular use case. So what we do is we look at websites and what types of information and metadata they have, and training resources, materials and events. We look at the attributes that they usually store, and then we look at the schemas that they have in schema.org. And we make proposals of different amendments for additions and for the changes that we would like to be able to see. We found them to be very receptive to change. We also add a sort of semantic layer into this to make things a bit more interoperable. So this isn't anything schema.org cares about, but we say, you know, if you want to be schema.org compliant, then you'll have to have this vocabulary in some of these fields. But if you want to be bioschemas compliant, then this is the minimum information that you must have, recommended and optional information, controlled vocabulary, so we can constrain terms to just using some pre-existing vocabulary, things like cardinality, so how many instances of an attribute can occur. And so we kind of come up with these things to aid interoperability so we can be more unambiguous when it comes to scraping websites that are using this technique. And so, yeah, it basically just allows us to be able to bring all of this into test. So we end up having websites that are bioscience compliant, and we can pass them without any input really whatsoever on our part. And now we can, yeah, it's even more difficult now to use an API than it is to do bioscience passing. So that's kind of the mechanism that we've developed, and we've been trying to coach people around Europe to implement on their training websites. Just mention briefly about the sort of collaboration points that I see is very useful between Erudite and TAS. So I'm really interested in some of the machine learning practices that they're implementing, especially when annotating tags and really supplementing the metadata. And maybe even things like finding tools, standards, data sets, containers, computer infrastructure might be areas that you guys would be interested in discovering more about. Harmonizing schemas. So we've kind of been working on this over the last few days, but Erudite and TAS are now going to be able to express the resources that we have in our websites in a common way so that we can be able to exchange our resources. And maybe we could sort of think about how we collaborate learning pathways and knowledge maps with one another. The other thing is Erudite people are using this, the SEO, as the sort of for the data science education resources. They have the vocabulary that they're using, as we're using one that's more about bioinformatics. So the bits that intersect here are kind of ones that we want to be able to exchange with one another. So providing a mapping between those two different anthologies, I think, would be a really good step to take. So this is just like a little, analogy about the two different approaches that we've both been taking to produce registries of resources. I think what TAS has done is created tools to be able to help extract information from sites that we've already identified, whereas Erudite has kind of taken lots and lots of stuff in and filtered it out, and then the end effect is that we're both trying to find valuable resources. So we've kind of worked on picking out quality resources and trying to get as many of them possible to raise the quantity of them, whereas you've sort of taken in a huge quantity of them and filtered them into nice quality resources. That's my little California perspective. So thank you very much. So sort of thank the test team and the people who've been working on bio schemas, and all of the content providers who test. To Jack for hosting this meeting.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.
Do you have any questions? Yes.
How do you control spam entries to tests? Like if someone submits something for being relevant?
Yeah. We've fortunately not really had much in the way of spam submissions. We do ask people to register before they add things to the website. And we have this I am not the robot button, which basically checks whether the IP address is from a regular spam. We've not had any yet, and most of the resources that we have in tests are aggregated, so it would require a compromise on the end source's website for us to be able to be automatically pulling in accidental things, which has never happened before. But, it would just require a bit of a,
You mentioned something about some of the workshops and things don't persist. Maybe they're one-off, or they evaporate or expire or what have you. Mm-hmm. In TESS, do you have a process by which you're going back through resources that you've indexed to make sure that they haven't disappeared, or that their links haven't gone stale, or that they're kept up to date as they're being refreshed?
We do, yeah. We have procedures in place that inform us whenever we've tried to scrape something and it's not present anymore. And that sort of brings us a little red flag. So as the sort of people with the creator curator accounts can identify those. We don't. I mean, like the events that have expired, the ones that are in the past, we haven't really tried to sort of ensure that the information is up to date, and we don't have any form of like versioning. A lot of the time, you have like an event, and it could be a recurring one that happens every several months. We don't have any sort of thing in place that sort of identifies that this is the same one repeating itself. So whenever that happens, it just creates a new record in test.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. That was great. Okay.